Well, thank you all for coming. Thank you for joining us today. I'm Kiki Takaraki. I'm one of your event managers for today, and I'm very glad to introduce Irene and Ryabaya, who's actually going to give this workshop. We're here to, if there's any problems or concerns, just come to me, find me on the side. I'm going to be just over there. I believe you're going to give some time for questions and this kind of stuff too throughout
bit, yeah.
So I'll be running some of the mics.
Hello?
Please raise your hand if you actually need a mic, and we'll try and accommodate as much as we can. And with that, I'll hand off to Irene. Thank you.
Hi, everyone. Can you guys hear me? Okay, awesome. So hello, everyone. It's such an honor to be here today among so many amazing women. Thank you to every one of you for showing up. Thank you to Grace Hopper, the organizers, the volunteers. You're doing a kick-ass job. Two disclaimers. I'm from New York, and I grew up outdoors, so there will be cursing. And number two is I'm going to make you talk to each other. Don't hate me. So, when people ask me, what do you do, right? Like, you're probably hearing this question all the time today. What do you do? These days, I say, I'm a professional feminist. And that is sort of a really weird answer. There was a time in my career when the answer was a lot simpler. I could say, I'm a developer at Goldman Sachs, or I'm an oil options trader for HETCO. But after about 10 years on Wall Street, I kind of got fed up with that, quit my job, and decided to start my own company and change the world and all that shit. And in my mind, and keep in mind, this was before all the recent publicity, it was about 3 years ago, in my mind, startups were this like brilliant utopia where all the sexual harassment and all the sexism and all that shit did not exist, right? Like, this is, we're building the future here, bots and AI and going to space. So like, it must be better, right? And then when my co-founder and I started it, we very quickly realized that somehow startups were than Wall Street. And that's when we drew a line in the sand and said, this is it. I'm not going to sit quietly here and take it anymore. We're going to do something about it. And that's when I became a professional feminist. And that's part of the reason that I'm here with you guys today. So, when people ask you, what do you do? What they're really asking for is, what can you do for me? Right? Like, what is the value that you could bring to this potential new relationship that we could start building here? Like, how do you fit into my life? And also, how could I fit into your life? And answering that question with I am job description at company name is a missed opportunity for that answer. Right? It's actually a huge missed opportunity. The hardest time for me to answer that question was when I was making these like giant career shifts. When I said, you know, I want to go from being a developer to being a trader, from someone who builds risk systems to someone who uses them. And I would go to networking events and they would ask me, okay, what do you do? And the actual right answer was, I'm a developer. But the answer I really wanted to give was, I want to be a trader, and here's 10 reasons why I would make a really kick-ass amazing trader. Please help me become a trader. So I learned all sorts of hacks and tricks and ways of sneaking that into the conversation. And thanks to the connections I made, I got a trading job offer in December of 2008 amidst the financial crisis. So it's possible, it's just really hard. The things got even worse when I quit my job completely and I decided to start be a startup founder. And I knew nothing about startups. My whole career was Wall Street. And I would go to all these events because what I decided is like, I have to learn, I have to meet people. I went to two events a night for 6 months with my co-founder and we would meet people and they would ask, what do you do? And I'm like, well, I don't work anywhere, and I do a lot every day, but it doesn't have a job description. I don't feel like I'm a founder yet. So sure, I'm coding up an app, and like, sure, I'm researching things, but I'm not a founder yet. And so it felt like I am a nothing. It was really awful, actually. It was really awful. And I don't think I would have survived that whole experience if I didn't realize one important thing. That I'm not my job. I really wasn't, right? What I am and what each of you are is the collection of your experiences, your skills, your unique mindset and outlook on things, and your potential. And that's what we need to remember when we're talking about and we're trying to give an answer to what do you do? It's this potential of what you could be doing, of what you want to be doing, right? I am actually an immigrant. I was born in the former Soviet Union. And when I first started working here, it was somewhat jarring for me when people would say, "I'm a doctor," or "I am an engineer," because in Russian, what you say is, "I work as a doctor," or "I work as an engineer." And reframing that thinking is super important now, more than ever before, because the future of work is changing faster than we can kind of handle in our minds, right? I don't know how many of you know, but most millennials will stick around at their jobs, and a lot of you guys are millennials, for an average of 18 months. Most jobs are changing faster than we know what to do with. 10 years ago, no one would say, "I'm a driver." And 10 years from now, very few people are gonna say, "I am a truck driver." And those are just like really blatant, stupid examples. There is a million more examples of things like that where "I am a dot, dot, dot" is not gonna exist, or a new something is gonna exist. So we need a new way to reframe and change this conversation about how to talk about who we are. And I'm really glad that Grace Hopper is having this conversation at this conference. It was just so perfectly timed. In this new age, because even if you stay with your employer, even if you stick around, your job is gonna change. So we need a new way to think about it. Unfortunately, that is really, really hard to do. So to actually talk about ways, talk about this in meaningful ways, you need to do some self-discovery. You need to figure out what it is that you're good at, what it is that you can offer beyond just the job description that you have. And we're gonna do a workshop about this in a little bit. I realized how hard it is for people to do this when we, my co-founder and I, started to do dinners for investors and entrepreneurs. When I reframed my own thinking, I realized that one thing really good at that a lot of the founders that I met were not, that didn't fit with any job description, was talking to investors. Because I spent 10 years on Wall Street, I could connect a lot of the angel investors in New York who happened to come from Wall Street. And a lot of founders couldn't. So we started doing these dinners where I would use that value that I could bring to bring founders around the table, introduce them to an investor, and have a meaningful conversation. And instead of just saying, "Oh, hi, this is my name and this is the company that I run," we decided to make the icebreakers more meaningful. We would go around and make sure all the founders would give an ask and an offer, right? Something that you need help with today and something that you can offer to the group. And we found that when this was successful, it made for amazing networking. We saw people get up from the table and run to each other to say, "Hey, I mentioned that you are a designer, and like, need to find a designer. Like, you mentioned that you're a recruiter and I really need to find this tech talent," or whatever, right? So it was a different way of talking. But we also found out that a lot of people didn't know how to give that offer. One woman, she got up and she's like, "Well, I don't know if I have anything to offer to the group. You know, maybe I shouldn't talk." We're like, "Well, where do you work?" "Well, I work at Amex." "Well, what do you do?" "Marketing." We're like, "Hold up a second. You've been working at Amex for 10 years in marketing. Every single startup needs marketing help. That's your offer." But the problem is she was sitting at a table of entrepreneurs and she's like, "I don't belong here." She had that same experience that I did when I first quit my job. We're like, "I'm not really doing anything that what's happening in this room, so what am I really? I'm a nothing," right? So we started to do these sessions to actually help people figure out what it is they can offer in a meaningful way beyond their typical job description. Once you figure out what it is you want to offer, we come across a little problem called the bragging backlash. Yeah. So during the session, during this little 10 minutes, I've been telling you about a lot of cool things I've done in my career, right? Like, I was a successful developer at Goldman, I transitioned to being a trader, I started my own business, blah, blah, blah. Science tells us that you are going to like me less because of this. Yeah. Research that you're going to actually think I'm more competent, but you're going to give me fewer resources because I dare do. And that, ladies, is fucked up. We need to stop that shit. Right? Like, no mas. Like, that can't happen anymore. So, because if we're going to talk about how we're going to help each other, we need to figure out what it is we can help each other with. And that means talking about our accomplishments. That has to happen, right? And so women resort to all sorts of tricks, and, you know, we give credit to other people, it was all the team, et cetera, et cetera. And that's great and that's important, but we still need a way to talk about our accomplishments. So I'm going to ask you that for the rest of the day, if you're talking to a and she's saying things that are true facts about her career, right? And somewhere in the back of your mind, you're going like, oh, the thing. Shut that down, right? You know, pause and reassess. Like, is she saying true about her career? If they're true, it's not bad, right? If they're true, she's just telling you what she did, which is awesome. If they're true, maybe she can help you with one of those things you need. So, This is hard, but I think we can do it. So I've been cut, and now I want you to we're going to do a little exercise. Take out your phones or notepads, whatever you like to do for scribbling. Your favorite form of scribbling, whatever it may be.
And you should all have a pen in your bags, courtesy of one of our sponsors.
I'm going to assume you all have a pen. And I want you to answer these three questions. And I want you to actually write down the answers. Don't just think of them. The first question is, what are you better at than most people? Chances are, this is in some way connected to your career. This is what you do professionally, right? Like, if you're doing something over and over again, you probably kick ass at it, right? Like, you can be an amazing developer, you could do great ad campaigns, like, whatever it is. And it could also be soft skills, like, you could be an amazing negotiator, or a great manager, whatever it is. What is it that you do better than almost everybody you meet? That's number one. Number two, and I'm going to run through them and then give you guys time to answer, is what do you love doing? When you're not on the clock and you're not getting paid and no one's watching, what do you do? Is it kitten photos? Is it food blogs? Right? Is it travel? So this is a really important one because when you're talking about networking, you're talking about making meaningful connections that add value to each other's lives. And sometimes you're going to meet awesome people and there's no way for you to really add value in that moment. And one way to do that is through actually personal loves and passions. Right? Before I was a professional feminist, feminism was a passion of mine. It just had nothing to do with my job description. Or another passion of mine is travel and hiking. So I connect with people by telling them about how much I travel, and I've been to 60 plus countries, and I'm happy to help you plan your trip to a weird place. Like, contact me, I'll help you. And I've made really deep and meaningful connections talking about the things I love with people with whom I otherwise had nothing to talk about with. That's number two. And then there's number three. What's really easy for you that's hard for, like, everybody else? And it sounds exactly like number one, but it's actually very different. The reason is, I'll give you an example. I'm really good at networking. I'm really good at it. But I'm also an introvert. It's actually really hard for me. It is a learned skill that I developed intentionally. By talking to people and reading books, it's literally something that I learned to do like an exercise. I'm really good at it. But it's really hard for me. Math, on the other hand, is really easy for me. Yet at this point, I kind of suck at it. Like, I'm not the whiz kid I was in high school. I haven't done math professionally for, you know, over a decade. I suck at math, but it's still really easy for me. Numbers don't scare me. So when someone has, you know, a spreadsheet and they don't know what to do with it, I'm happy to sit down with them, go through the spreadsheet, and calm down their anxiety. Math is my safe and happy place. But I actually suck at it. Like, I'm not solving any formulas anytime soon. So please answer these three questions. I'm going to give you guys 5 minutes, and then we're going to do the next exercise. One way to cheat on this, by the way, and this goes back to a little bragging, we're so conditioned to not brag that we sometimes can't think of answers to these things. It's really like messed up beyond belief. So our friends are sometimes better at answering these questions for us. So if you can't come up with an answer, text your best friend or your closest coworker. They will answer them for you. Is everyone done? Okay. I can't whistle, so. The really cool thing is once you figure out what you're really good at and what you love and what's easy for you, then those are the things you can help someone with. Those are the valuable things you can offer to a new relationship. So how do we sneak those in to your very first conversation with that person, right? Rather than saying like, I am a developer at Google, we can say, hi, my name is Jane. I work as a developer at Google, and I love helping people with, I don't know, planning their trips, or working on their business models, or doing their Google ads, right? Whatever you decided you love to do or you're amazing at, and you can also switch them up based on events and based on the audience, based on your read of the situation. You can figure out, in this case, I'm going to talk about my love of travel. And in that case, I'm going to talk about the fact that I'm really, really amazing at building pitch decks or whatever it is, right? Or helping people interview. So in that very first conversation, you can say like, I really love helping people with this. And people really like that. People really like knowing that you're a helpful person that wants to offer something right away. People remember that. So what I want to do, and you guys are doing an awesome job talking without my help, but turn to a person on your right, preferably someone you haven't met yet, and try on this introduction.
Yeah.
guys.
All right. So, the really cool thing about this exercise is that you, once you write these things down, and I actually recommend you keep a list of this, like keep a note on your phone of answers to these questions. And before you go to a networking event, read them to yourself. And if there's a new one, because guess what? Our skills, our needs, our wants, our likes, they change. So if there's a new one that comes up since the last time you looked at it, add it. If one no longer applies, delete it. But if you refresh that, if you prime your mind to think about the ways that you are awesome at, what you're amazing at, what it's easy for you, what you love, what you're passionate about. When you go into a networking event like this with a million people that you all want to talk to, it's so much easier to talk about why a relationship with you is really valuable. It's so much easier. If you just go in there and you're like stressing about the last project that maybe didn't go so well, it's a lot harder, right? So keep this note and remind yourself before you go into a room of a lot of awesome people why it is that they should all be friends with you. So, all right, part two. So, this part is more about the ask. The first part is about the offer, what you can offer to a relationship. But this part is about what you want to get out of a potential new relationship. And so, yet again, three things, and I want you to actually write them down. What is it that you do today in your job or your project, whatever it is you're working on? So this, right? The second part is, what do you want to be doing? And this part is often harder. Tomorrow, next month, next year, 10 years from now, what is it that you want to be? And it could be, you know, a nice progression in your career where you are now. It could be a jump to a different team in your company. It could be the same job but in a different company. It could be something completely unrelated to anything you've ever done before. Be really, 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 really honest with yourself about this. And if what you want seems completely unattainable and stupid, write it down anyway. Just do it. And number six is, what do you need to make number two real? What people, things, resources do you need in a perfect world to go from one to two? Write them all down and make it very clear to yourself. If I get these things, if I get this introduction, or if I get this kind of class, whatever it is, you know, if I get this much money, whatever it is, that's how I can get to my dream. So I'm going to give you 5 more minutes to write it down. So there's a lot of power to knowing what you want and what you need to get there. Because you can start telling people this. And I'll give you an example. There was a time when my co-founder and I decided that we wanted to put on an all-women hackathon in New York. And I don't know how many of you know this, but finding space in New York is incredibly difficult. Every square inch is super expensive. So we went around, and this was the time we went to 2 events a night. So we went around and we told everyone that, hey, we're working on this all-women hackathon. And what we need is to meet the kind of people who could give us space, because we need space and sponsorship for the food for this event. And for 2 out of the 3 months that we went around talking about this, the only place that hackathon existed was in our heads. That's it. Right? You can start talking about what you want to do and talking about it as if it's happening, and the universe will actually conspire to give it to you as long as you ask. Right? And as long as you ask while you're also offering something. So if you start the conversation by saying, like, here I am, this is what I'm doing right now, I love to help people doing this, and by the way, I'm also working on this project, and it's really great, and, you know, maybe that project is my own promotion, or maybe that project is an all-women hack, and I need this kind of thing to make it happen, right? If it's a promotion, maybe I need a mentor or a sponsor, right? And if it's a new startup, maybe you need investors. And you go around and you pretty much blatantly tell people what you need. And if you ask enough people, they will actually help you. It's amazing to me, and I'm literally blown away by it almost every day, how much we women help each other. And it's something that inspires me all the time. But the problem is we can't help each other if we don't ask. So you can use this statement in conjunction with this new different kind of introduction to say, this is what I want. This is who I want to be. This is what I want to add to the world. And this is what I need to make it happen. Can you do it? Can somebody else that you know do it? The crazy thing also, even if the person you're talking to can't help you directly, they will almost always brainstorm with you about how to get to the resources. They're like, well, I don't know anybody at Amazon, but you know, if what you need is Amazon, let's talk about like what events do they speak at? Maybe, you know, we can go together. So we're gonna do one last exercise, which is turn to the person on your left now, do the introduction we just practiced, and add this. Put in that thing you wanna do, whatever it is, and the kinds of resources, and give it a try. It's not so scary.
And feel free to move around the room. We're not stuck to those chairs.
I was afraid to say that because the room's really full. Usually I'm like,
hey.
Get your butts up, yes.
Yes. I was wondering if you want to
Some quiet, please.
Okay.
Some quiet, please. Thank you.
Yeah. So. I hope you learned something interesting about the people next to you. The really interesting thing about this is that it is a stepping stone to finding your IMA that's not just your job description, right? This is like the way to get there. You start to figure out what it is that is really your value beyond your current job. And it takes time, and some of us, like, we don't need to get there. But how to answer that IMA with a really interesting way that makes people connect to you meaningfully. One of the reasons that I love saying I am a feminist, or more importantly, I'm a professional feminist, is because I get to connect with a lot of people that are important to me who otherwise don't actually give a shit about what I do on a daily basis. It's true. What I actually do is run an incubator for women-led businesses, right? But if I meet someone who's not a startup founder, who's not an investor, who may not even know what an incubator is, who doesn't give a shit about startups in general, I can still talk to them in a meaningful way as long as they are excited about the feminist mission. And that's it, right? We can still have an important conversation. It can be meaningful. We can connect. So once I figure that out, I scrap this and I have my answer. And it may take you a while to get there, but I know you can if you want to. So that's it for the talk. I'm sure you guys learned something interesting. And we're going to open it up to questions. Oh, thank you.
Sorry. Actually, if you guys would like to actually come in the center here, whoever has questions, and I'll pass the mic here because this room is very, very, very full.
If you stand up, we'll form a line here.
All right, go on.
Hi, my name's Carrie, and I'm like relatively new to my career. So my question is, like, how do you start these kind of conversations with people that are like more senior than you? Like, because it's kind of intimidating. Like, you don't want, you feel like they're so busy and they don't have time for somebody that's as low level as you are. But like, you also know that they're the ones that can probably help you the most.
Yep. So I am one of these people who, in my first review in Goldman Sachs, there was literally a quote that said, she should know who she's talking to, like in black and white. Yeah, it's that bad. So I just am shameless. what I do with people who are more senior than me, or in situations where I just know nothing, right? Like when I'm with people who just are knowledge experts in a field, is I ask a lot of questions. Right? So I say, hi, you know, I'm this person, like, this is something that is cool about me, but really I want to learn about you. And people love talking about themselves. This is a fact, this is a known fact, right? So the people talking about themselves, even if they actually learn very little about you, they still remember you as like a pleasant conversation or a pleasant interaction. And you get to learn something about them. And then what can happen is if you get their contact information, you can get in touch with them and then say, okay, there's this thing that you told me about, which is really cool. And then I did some research and I did something else. And like, here's some way that I could potentially help you participate or do something, right? So like, find out what they need the most and see if there's any way into their universe at all. The other trick that I've learned while doing all this is telling people, how can I help you? Even when that's absurd, right? When that's like completely absurd and you're talking to the CEO of a Fortune 500 company, say it anyway. It throws them off guard, right? Because what happens with really important high-level people is it's like, need, 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 take, take, take. Right? And all of a sudden you're like, it's really great to meet you. How can I help you? They don't know what to do with that answer and they remember you.
So I have a question. I think you kind of covered it in the talk, but I would like to dive deep into it. You said you quit Wall Street trading and jumped into having your own startup. Mm-hmm. What motivated you or what was the tipping point that led you to make that leap or jump?
So the reason I got into Wall Street is because I was very much like a poor immigrant kid. And my whole motivation in life when I was in school was that I had to make money. That's it. Like, I had to make money, I had to support my family, I had to pay the mortgage. And what I really loved in school was math. And then someone told me, well, you can't make money doing math, which is a lie. But I listen to them, and I'm like, all right, well, what's the closest thing to math that can make money? Well, programming. So when I went to NYU, I actually graduated with a comp sci degree. And when I was talking to people about, like, okay, what should I do with my life now that I'm kind of in my second year or whatever, Goldman Sachs actually came on campus. And I didn't know what Goldman Sachs was, what an investment bank does. Again, like, I was a poor kid. My grandmother called it Goldman Sachs. Yep. I had no idea. And my friend dragged me to this event because she needed somebody at a networking event. And I started talking to their recruiting head for their tech department. I'm like, you guys are working on some like really interesting shit. And like, you guys are offering me a lot of money. I'm down. Like, I'm cool with it. Trading was another transition that was very much motivated by money, but about 10 years into it, my family stabilized and, like, you know, I was a grown up. All of a sudden, money wasn't the primary motivator, and I was starting to look for meaning. And when I looked around and I was like, this job that I do where I push money from point A to point B, it's great. And like, I'm really grateful for the, like, I'm really grateful for the money as someone who came from nothing, but there's zero meaning to it. And I was actually depressed. And my husband talked me into quitting. Because he's like, you'll never do anything else while you're stuck doing this.
Hi, thanks so much for the awesome presentation. That was really good. I'm sure everyone in the room would say so too. I'm curious to hear about what led you to start up Monarq Incubator and your journey that took you that in that direction.
Sure. So as I mentioned, like, when we left Wall Street, Dan and I, so when I was a trader, she was a broker. That's how we met. A friend was like, there's no women in this industry. You guys should go hang out. So we met and we're like, I hate my job. I'm quitting. She's like, I hate my job. I'm quitting too. We quit. We traveled to weird places. Like, we did a hike in Borneo, Malaysia. It was really, you know, she was the only one who would go with me. We rock climbed. So we became friends. And then when we got into startups, it was very much like a what the fuck moment. Like, why is this still so bad? Like, if this is what's going to be the future of our country, I can't let it continue like this. So we, yet again, we knew nothing. So we started doing these events for women in tech. So we did like dinners and breakfasts and panels where we introduced entrepreneurs to investors. And the way we met these investors is we would go to networking events and we were obnoxious enough to like come up to the speakers and like get their email and like somehow get them to answer us. And then we would introduce them to the founders. So like we were the middlemen. All at the same time, we were actually working on a startup of our own. It was this friendship app. It was like Tinder for friends. And so we actually finished it. Like, we built it. I coded up a piece of it. We launched it. We got thousands and realized we absolutely hated it and had no interest in doing that, but really loved the events we were doing for founders. And so slowly but surely, we got to a point where we had to pick. We couldn't do like three businesses at the same time, doing these hackathons, doing these dinners, running the app. And we had to pick one. And we're like, well, just doing dinners isn't really a business. And we did a proper like gap analysis, like the Excel dorks that we are. And we looked at like what exists in the industry. And we realized there's a lot of resources for women who want to start their companies. Like, there's a lot of boot camps and classes and online stuff you can take. Like, if you know nothing and you want to start, there's a lot of stuff there. And then there's a bunch of women who are doing amazing things and becoming angel investors, helping women become angel investors, starting VC funds. So there's like more and more of a bigger pile of money adding up for women with successful businesses. But the gap between I started it and I'm ready to raise $1 million is huge. And there's almost nothing for those women. And I can tell you why now, but it's a very long conversation. But we realized that someone needs to bridge that chasm because that's where most women fail. Like, and I hate the word pipeline, but yes, the fucking pipeline. Right? So like, we are among the few people who are in that hole, and I hope that more and more women will do this. And there's two other women-focused incubators in this country, Merge Lane in Colorado, or like the ones that we met in Refinery in Connecticut, but there was nothing in New York. And we were pretty appalled because New York is supposed to be like the best place for women entrepreneurs, and there was like nothing really there. So we just did it. Nope, I think we need the mic.
Hey, Irene. Here.
in the corner of the room over here.
Oh, hi. Oh, sorry.
thank you for the great talk. You mentioned that you excel at networking, but you are an introvert. Mm-hmm. So I was curious to learn about, it's a big challenge to get there. So if you can share some tips and tricks that work for you.
Yes. That wasn't easy, I'll be honest with you. And stupidly enough, it doesn't really get easier. I literally come to events, walk into the room and go, nope, and leave. Like, I did that last week, right? Like, two events that are run by women that I know who asked me to be there, and I just come in and I'm like, I can't do it, right? Like, there are nights I just can't do it. And what's really cool about it is that the people around me know I'm an introvert, like the people close to me, so my co-founder, my husband, my best friend, my sister. So when they come with me, they actually kind of like act as protectors. And I think that's really important to have a friend go with you who knows that's how you work. That's one. Two is, no, it's okay. Like, sometimes it's not gonna work. And like, allow yourself to be who you are. Fine, right? Like, yes, there are all these people and they're schmoozing around. And you're like, oh God, I wish I was that person. It's okay not to be. That's not you, right? The interesting thing about us introverts is we form really deep connections. We are really amazing at it. We listen more than we talk. We ask questions. So you might make fewer connections at an event, but chances are they will be deeper, they will last longer, and they will give you higher returns if you want to think about it that way. Another way to do it, and this was my co-founder helped me a lot with this, is to kind of set yourself goals. Like when you're doing something really hard, you should have goals. So we would say like, okay, we're going to go to this event and we're going to talk to five people. And we're going to talk to five people on this particular subject, right? This is where having the ask, I think, is super important, because if you know why you are there, it gets a lot easier. Like if you're standing in a room of 150 impressive people and you're like, I don't know why I'm here, it's so much worse. Like it's, you know, it's horrible. So if you're like, okay, I'm here for this purpose and I just need to talk to five people about this thing, have my, you know, conversation kind of like half prepared, it becomes easier. It becomes like an exercise, like going to the gym. Maybe not pleasant, but doable. Okay? And then eventually it gets slightly easier because you start to rehearse the conversation over and over again. But I would suggest, especially if you're an introvert and you don't just like schmoozing for schmoozing, which my co-founder loves at it. She just like, you know, she'll walk into a room, my husband's the same way. Like they'll walk into a room and they'll just like talk to everybody. And I find it magical. I can't do it. So if you walk into that room and you're like, okay, I need to talk to five people, this is what I'm going to say, and you manage to meet a couple that you're really connecting with, like hang out in the room and chat and maybe talk to more people. But if you're kind of in a shitty mood, you've talked to your five, you've said your thing, go home. Give yourself permission.
Hi, amazing talk. Thanks for sharing all those insights. One question that I had was, you talked about how you kind of figured out what was meaningful for you and what you loved, but how, what was your journey to figure out, okay, this is what I wanted to do, or like, how did you get there?
Yeah, so that's a really excellent question. Figuring out what you love and what your passion is really, 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 really hard, right? Like this one workshop isn't gonna be your whole answer. It took me a long time, almost 2 years. And the first 6 months when I quit my job, I felt really, really stupid because I was like still semi-depressed. And it was summer in New York City. You know, I had enough money in my bank account to have a pleasant life, so I wasn't stressed about money. I had all of my amazing friends and I was sitting on the couch depressed, right? Like, what the fuck is wrong with me? This is the dream. Like, I don't understand. And that was because I was lacking meaning, right? Like, I'm not good at doing nothing. Most of us are good at doing nothing. Nice to go on vacation, have a week off or three. It's not good to just do nothing for a long time. The way I discovered meaning, and I think that's the way a lot of people do it, is you try a bunch of shit, right? So make that list of the things you think you want to do and try them. And you're going to very quickly discover the ones that you were wrong about. Like I said, we built the freaking app. Like I was a founder, and because we had talked to all these investors, they were asking us for when they should be investing in us already, right? And I was literally having these conversations with like, oh, you know, we're not right fundraising yet. And like, because inside I realized that wasn't it. And I was actually scared, and it's something Diana and I learned. We didn't have that conversation with each other because she was feeling the same way, but we were scared to tell each other that this wasn't really it. But I think the only way is A, try things, be intentional about it, and then be honest with yourself when it's not working. And it will take a long time.
Last question.
Can you share some tips about dealing with people who interrupt you a lot and you can't just avoid them?
Yep. So, depends on the setting. And I've done it a few different ways. So when I was in corporate, one thing I actually did is, like, when you have, I was the only woman in the room my whole career. Like, it's the only thing I know. And I went from being the only woman in the room to a room full of women. It's awesome. So one thing I would talk to about, like, my guy friends who I worked with, whether my supervisors or someone, you know, even like someone who worked for me technically, my male allies, and say, like, listen, this fucking asshole keeps interrupting me. When he does, can you interrupt him? Right? And so I would literally be in meetings when one of my, you know, really good friends, Prashant, would go like, she was talking. Right? And that shut them up really fast. Wow. Yeah. And so that's one way. And this is like one of the reasons I think that including men in our feminist agenda is insanely important. Insanely, like, we can't do this alone. And we're not building a world. And I know this is blasphemous, but the future isn't female. The future is 50-50. Yeah. Right? Like, that's what I firmly believe. Right? So including guys in your battle. And then also, if they actually help you, like saying, like, thank you, you did that thing, like, fucking awesome, can I buy you a drink? Right? And if it's just you having a conversation with someone, and yet again, this is just my approach, but I'm pretty blatant and to the point. And I say, like, hey, can I speak? Like, do you actually want to hear my point? Because if you don't want to hear my point, then, you know, why are we here? Like, I can go, you know, I can go for a walk. So that's my approach. It doesn't work for everyone. But it's very effective for me. Like, I just call them out on it blatantly. And I think given all the conversations that are going on in the media, it's fair. Yeah. Ruth Bader Ginsburg is writing about it. Like, you know, some of them actually don't do it intentionally. I think that's it. Thank you guys so much.